Before I read the gospel lesson, I just wanted to say thank you again for your welcome. Always make us feel like we belong here, and we appreciate that. I was surprised to see our names on your sign by the stream. Honored that finally I got equal billing with Shirley. Appreciate that. The last time I was here, it was this Sunday after Christmas, the other low-attended Sunday. The Sunday after Easter, Fred Craddock, the finest preacher I've ever heard, has this in one of his writings. He taught preaching at Candler School of Theology at Emory University in Atlanta. My student in preaching class, he wrote, after one semester was invited to preach in his home church. We know what Sunday it was. It was the Sunday after Christmas when nobody's there. Or the Sunday after Easter. Glad you're here. I guess they figure since there are so few people here, how much harm can he cause? Would you hear this wonderful story from the Gospel of John? It was the evening of the resurrection morning. They're huddled together in Jerusalem in a house. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the marks of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the marks and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out with your hand and put it in my side. And do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We had just gone to sleep, and we heard the noise downstairs. Shirley woke me with a start. "Harold, somebody downstairs." checked out, and so I asked Shirley if she would go down and see what was going on. After a while, we continued to hear the noises, and I got up to go to the door to go down, trembling, and she said, "No, no, call 911. So we did, called 911, and the police came. And they kept me on the phone while they came, and they did their surveillance around the house, and then they said to me, "We've looked all around the outside. We want you now to come down and unlock the door so we can come in and explore inside with you." And so I unlocked the door, and they came in, and we looked around, and there was nothing. Not an animal, not a prowler, not a thief, not a ghost. Nothing. But it was a frightening number of moments. It must have been like that, but even worse for these disciples in Jerusalem. Jesus has been dragged out and crucified and killed, and they're now wondering, are they going to be next? And they're hiding, the text says. They're hiding in this house in Jerusalem for fear that they might be the next ones to be dragged out over that hill and crucified. The doors are locked. The windows are open. They're being quiet. Whenever they hear a noise, their hearts begin to pound, or if they hear any creaking footsteps, they hold their breath. Shh. Fearing that knock at their door. They're to be next. And then, in the midst of that anguish and uncertainty and fear, with the doors locked and the windows covered, Jesus appears before them. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. It's too good to be true. There are some things that are hard to believe. Because they knew he was dead. You know he was dead. Ask the women who went and got the spices and the herbs to prepare his body for burial, and you will hear them say between sobs, "Yeah, he's gone." Ask the Roman soldiers whose job it was to crucify him. Was he dead? Oh, he was dead. It's our job to make sure that happens, and we are good at our job. Oh, he was dead. He's dead. Ask the disciples who kind of stayed away from the cross, back in the back of the crowd, out of fear, and they will tell you, "We saw him suffer in anguish. We saw the spear being put in his side. Yeah, he's dead." It was a good run. They had seen him perform miracles, heard him share these wonderful words of wisdom, inspired them with his word and his deed. But it was over now. He was dead. And yet, here, unbelievably, he appears before them in this house. Some things are really hard to believe. I have heard people over the years say that if only I had been there, if only I had been able to see it, as Thomas wanted to see it, then I could believe in a resurrection. And yet, even though Thomas gets a bad rap, and we call him Doubting Thomas, the others required the same evidence that he wanted. It was. easy for them. In the 24th chapter of Luke, the women have gone to the tomb, they find it empty, and their response is they're afraid. In John 20, Mary is at the tomb and she sees the tomb empty and she's talking with Jesus and doesn't know it, doesn't even recognize it. Later on in that chapter, Peter and John run to the tomb and see that it's empty, and they come back to the house in Jerusalem, and it says they did not understand. Luke again says that the women went to the tomb, and then they finally recognized him, and they came back to the disciples and said, "We have seen the risen Lord." And the disciples said, "Women gossip, idle tale. We'd like to believe it, but he's dead." Some things are really hard to believe. When I was young, baseball was my life. No, you might have liked baseball. Baseball was my life. It's the only thing that ultimately drove me to go to college. But at 12 years old, I was growing up in the country in the Poconos, and those of you from the Philadelphia area may not appreciate it, but I was a Brooklyn Dodger fan. Brooklyn Dodger, not Los Angeles, Brooklyn Dodger. It was one of the radio stations from New York that we could get up there, and I remember so many nights going to sleep, listening with my ear to that Philco radio next to the bed, turning it down so it wouldn't disturb the family, listening to the game. Jackie Robinson was my hero. I'd seen a movie of him, and I saw how he ran sort of with his feet pointed in, almost a little pigeon-toed, and he was so quick. And I tried to run like that. It never made me any faster. But he was my hero. In fact, when I was 12, I had the audacity to write a letter to Jackie Robinson, telling him of my love for the game and of my admiration for him. Weeks later, our mailbox was right along Route 209 across the road from our house. It was right after Christmas. And I remember going out the gravel driveway across the road over to that mailbox on a post and opening the mailbox. And there was a penny postcard with my name on it. From Jackie Robbins. From Jackie Robbins. From 1950. Looking at our geography book, it was a fairly large book, and it had a number of pictures in, not color pictures. This was before color was invented. They were black and white. I remember seeing pictures of the Egyptian pyramids. Wow, they must be something. They're so old and so magnificent and so huge. Shirley and I were in Cairo, and we got in a car with our driver and guide, and he drove us out to the edge of the city. And I remember getting out of that car, closing the door and turning around, and there these ancient pyramids. I was standing in front of these pyramids. Me, there they are. Some things are really hard to believe. Like when I asked Shirley to marry me. Yeah, it was after long laughter that she and she said, yes. Some things are hard to believe. In the Gospel of John, in the 12th chapter of that Gospel, there's a story that some of you will remember. Jesus healed a man who was born blind. Everyone was struck by it. Even his parents and the religious leaders, concerned that Jesus might gain some power and authority, they began to question, well, it can't be, it can't really have happened. And so they went to the man and they asked him, who is this who gave you sight, if you really are telling the truth? And he said, I don't know him. All I know is that I was born blind, and he must be a prophet of God. Because from the beginning of the history of the world, it has never been known that a man has been born blind, and later his sight was given to him. They didn't want to believe it. Some things are hard to believe. And if you can't believe that sight was given, how can you begin to believe that for the first in history, one who was dead, we know he was dead, but now he's alive. Among them, speaking with them, moving with them. When I was here after Christmas, we talked about how magnificent it was that the God of this vast, vast universe would choose to come to our little speck of a planet in this vast universe and be among us in Jesus. That was big. This is big. The one who is dead has been resurrected and is alive. And the world is changed because it happened. History has been changed because it happened. My life has been changed because it happened. Jesus, who was dead, has conquered sin. He who was dead has conquered death. He has given us the hope for life after life. Hope for life after death. Because he lives, we have the hope for life eternal through his forgiveness and salvation of us. That's the power of this resurrection. It changes. It just changes everything. When I get discouraged and begin to lose the sense of hope, I try to remember that every day is Easter and resurrection is real. And when I begin to lose hope, I try to remember just give me Jesus. In the morning when I
When I am alone, oh, and when I